All right, well, thank you for the introduction. Today we're going to be talking about molding and engineering and high performance resins with 3D printed mold tools. More specifically, things like PEEK, ULTEM, LCP, really high temperature, high strength, and really high performance resins is going to be the focus. So to start off, let's talk about how you're able to mold with these types of resins. So the biggest determining factor, right, is the material that you're going to be printing with. And that's our material is called digital tooling. So it's a proprietary resin that was developed in partnership with Henkel Loctite. So Henkel developed the base resin and then sends it to us. And then we actually compound in ceramic fibers that are metallized and then magnetically aligned on the printer to create a high strength, super rigid, and really high HTT material. So as you can see on the data sheet, we have an over 300 C heat deflection temperature, which is roughly around 600 degrees Fahrenheit. And that's really what allows us to use materials like PEEK, ULTEM, and everything that's in that 700 to 800 degree Fahrenheit melt temperature range. That HTT and that strength is really what allows us to mold those materials. And then also some unique features of this material is that it can be polished up to an A2 finish. So while it won't be a straight mirror finish, you are able to get really aesthetic looking parts, even if it's just for prototyping. So when choosing the correct part for 3D printed tooling, there's really three main factors that go into it. So it's part size, parts that fit in a 6x6 box are ideal. And on the next slide, I'll show some examples of that. And then the reason being is that this keeps the print time down. So over just overnight, between 8 to 12 hours, then it also keeps your material costs down. So you're really producing mold inserts that are cost effective and fast. The quantity of parts. So long cycle times are kind of synonymous with 3D printed tooling. Because you're using polymers that are insulators, you're not going to be able to dissipate heat quite as quickly. So your cooling times are going to be significantly longer. Now there's a ton of work going into adding in cooling lines and trying to speed up that cycle time, but you're still not going to be at full production levels. So anything above, you know, 1,000 to 1,500 parts can become pretty cumbersome unless you can run in full auto, which is certainly possible with some parts. And then part complexity is a key. So while part complexity becomes free with 3D printed tooling, there are some limitations as far as feature size goes. So there are limitations, but complexity can also be a key driver into when to adopt 3D printed mold tooling. Because like I just mentioned, it's free. So if you had to add in slides or special ejection, like a stripper plate, all of those things are free. They're just taken up on the print bed. So you're not adding in extra machining time or any extra finishing work. So here's a couple examples of some really good part sizes. So 53 millimeter diameter, that fits well within the print bed. You can probably get two or three iterations of the mold on at a time. So you're really able to prototype two different parts with just one build. So that's an overnight build. So in 3 days, you're able to prototype two different iterations of the same part or possibly two different parts. And then this is an unfilled PEI or ULTEM airplane badge. It's 95 millimeters by 50 millimeters. This is another great example. It's a relatively flat part, but it's pretty wide. And that's a great example of a part that you can fit on, you know, two or three molds on a build at a time. So you're really able to jump through different iterations, whether you want to try different surface textures or, you know, something else with the design, you're really able to do that. Complexity. So here's another key driver. Complexity is probably the largest driver for when you are choosing a part. You are able to use inserts, slides, collapsible cores, metal pins. All of those things de-risk your tool failure, but allow for super complex parts to be created. So because you can print multiple of inserts or slides on a build at a time, if something were to happen and something either chipped off or broke a little bit or possibly deflected, you're able to just pop in another one with really minimal cost and minimal time. Undercuts, high aspect ratio cores, that's where we start to get to the limitations of 3D printed tooling. Undercuts are going to be hard to jump off of just because the material is not metal. So when you're flexing off, something greater than half a millimeter, there is a risk of tool failure there. This can be kind of reserved for materials like polypro, TPE, and then some polyethylenes. Because those materials are relatively flexible, you are able to kind of jump those undercuts. Threads, this is a great way to use 3D printed tooling. Our threads always come out really crisp, really nice, and we have tried with different mating parts from either aluminum tools or steel tools, and they're really good. They fit, they're watertight, so they're no extra cost, but they're a great value add. And then slides and side actions. These are another great way that you can use insert molding, kind of. So they can be hand actuated, or if you have the capability on your press, you can actually fully automate those slides. But this is a great way to use 3D printed tooling, because instead of paying 10 or 15 grand for just a prototype aluminum tool with automatic ejection with slides, you can do this same automatic ejection, but for only $300 or $400. So this is a really great way to utilize 3D printed tooling when you have a complex part that you need in your end use material, rather than spending that $10,000 to $20,000 for an aluminum tool, or for maybe even more for a steel tool. You're able to spend a few hundred dollars and get the same part quality for a limited quantity, but without any sacrifices on that part complexity. And then here's the last key piece of when you're going to choose 3D printed tooling, or why you choose 3D printed tooling. So if you need a prototype that needs to exhibit the same function as its end use part, this is a real no-brainer way to do that. So tensile and impact testing shows that there's a 0 to 5% difference in the results from Fortify's test pieces from the data sheet from the materials that we molded. And most data sheets will actually just show the best results. It's dependent on the manufacturer, but a lot of times they'll just show the best results that they were able to obtain for tensile and impact testing, which is obviously impacted by the processing conditions of the actual parts themselves. So we find there's really identical function between parts molded on Fortify tooling as compared with aluminum or steel tooling. This process for, you know, using 3D printed tooling is really ideal for things like a flip top cap with a living hinge, specifically a butterfly hinge, and then comparing different materials and mold textures, whether that's consumer goods, whether that's defense. You're going to need what your actual end use part will look like, and this is really the only way to prototype that in that end use material. Another key detail is that you get patent and ITAR protection when you're keeping your prototype molding either in-house or at a trusted supplier, rather than sending it out and overseas and not really knowing what's being done. You're also getting it done much quicker when you're using 3D printed tooling. It's important to note that the parts are not going to be aesthetically perfect. You are going to have some digitization of the surface that comes with 3D printing. So if you're familiar with the DLP printing process, you're going to be familiar with the type of surface resolution that you're going to have. Like I mentioned previous, it can actually be polished, so you can get to an A2 finish. So if those layer lines are not ideal for you, you are able to polish those away. DFM, part function, and mold design are all verified very early on in the process when using 3D printed tooling, as opposed to going to aluminum tooling. You're likely to spend a lot more time doing your, you know, mold design verification and a lot less time actually getting your prototyping done. So using 3D printed tooling is a cheap, fast way to verify all of those things, whether it's part function, how your part looks, and also your mold design. So all of that stuff gets done super early and very cost effective. So with that, I'm going to take a quick break and hand this over to Bob so we can talk a little bit about Conventus, their material portfolio, and then we'll bring it back and talk a little bit about how you can use the high performance materials from Conventus and then the 3D printed tooling from Fortify to really optimize your prototyping in the molding space.
Thank you, Craig. I'm going to very quickly introduce my company, Conventus Polymers, and just walk through some of the more interesting and unique products that many engineers may not even be aware of. So who's Conventus? Founded in 2012, Conventus is a rapidly growing distributor with a pointed focus on application development. We pride ourselves on being able to find a solution for just about any application, but we really focus outside of your commodity polyolefins into engineering thermoplastics and high-performance polymers. This includes materials like polyetheramide, or ULTEM, as Craig had alluded to, polycellphones, PEEK, polycarbonate, nylons, and different blends. We focus on aiding companies with complex needs, including industry standards, which can prove challenging, UL, NSF, ISO, 10993 for healthcare as examples. And we were just voted Plastics News Best Place to Work for the supplier category this year. So we're quite proud of you know, how far we've come. This is the line card which Conventus carries. I'm not going to read through this. Everybody here, I presume, can read. We're happy to offer the line card to anybody that's interested in it after the webinar. I'm not going to walk you through the more standard engineering thermoplastics today either. Polymers like polycarbonate, ABS, polycellophane, and acrylics have a long established and critical role in the plastics industry. I expect, again, most people know what those are. With 3D Fortify's novel ability to create highly custom solutions to their printed tooling, I wanted to make sure that we focus on unusual materials that customers often find meets kind of your more unique set of needs that you may come across. So the first novel material I'd mention is a polyolefinic ketone or poketone. Not to be confused with the very expensive PEEK family of materials, polyolefinic ketone is a tough, chemically resilient, high-flowing semi-crystalline material with best-in-class abrasion resistance. It has fantastic functional toughness and is taken off in fluids or fluidics, toys, oil and gas, electrical connectors, and several other emerging markets just within the last 24 months. So this is a product that's really exploded in growth in really short order. And we've seen it work for applications like the interior of a helmet or many other applications, including, you know, toys where kids can't bite through them. It's really unique, really interesting. Our fantastic relationship with Ems Grivery also includes access to the TR series of amorphous nylons. A year and a half ago, I had never heard of an amorphous nylon before. But along with the other nylon 12 products that Ems carries, which became synonymous really with metal to plastic replacement opportunities, this TR series of materials gives you a great balance of incredible impact, fantastic light transmission, you know, up to about 91%, unparalleled UV stability, so near acrylic levels of UV stability, and terrific chemical resistance too. So if you need all of these things, if you need impact, you need UV, you need chemical resistance, and you know, again, you want all of them in one unit, one application with great clarity, the TR series really is unlike anything else and is the only real fit for that type of job. We offer a litany of different sustainable options. I've got a slide of all the different things that we carry in the sustainable universe. But I think maybe the most interesting product is a 56% bio-based polycarbonate, which is kind of strange to even call a polycarbonate in the first place. It's based on a sorbitol technology. So there's no bisphenol in the backbone of this material. And working with Sabic in the past, I was always taught that bisphenol is the backbone of polycarbonate. So that's clearly not the case here. This product has superior properties to PC in just about everything but impact. Its impact is very high, but it's not quite as high as you'll see with polycarbonate. However, if it's a lens or a fascia type application, it's going to have better hardness, better scratch resistance, higher light transmission, and better UV stability than polycarbonate. So something that's really interesting and you know, again, new, novel, and I think worth checking out. The final product I wanted to briefly touch on today is a syndiotactic polystyrene. Again, the name, kind of like with the polyketone material, might be deceptive because polystyrene I associated with that really brittle, weak material that's crystal clear, highly amorphous, and you know, breaks extremely easily is used in, say, plastic cutlery. This material is entirely different. It's semi-crystalline, and it has incredible heat deflection temperature relative to its cost. So this isn't a very expensive material, but it can stand up to temperatures up to about 500 HDT in Fahrenheit, of course. Similar to a polymer like PPS, which would obviously be significantly more expensive. It also has outstanding flow, so you can fill apart very easily. The mechanical property retention is really high. It does very, very well in moisture. In fact, it's probably the best product when it comes to hydrolytic stability out of all of the engineering thermoplastic materials. It's got outstanding electrical properties. So if you are looking for something that has great short-term temperature properties and good electrical properties and good resistance to moisture for a lot of different applications, not only is this probably the best fit, but it's a fit that's extremely inexpensive, relative, of course, to those high temperature, high performance materials. And that's what kind of makes it interesting. So that was it. That was the final product I wanted to make sure that we touched on today. Of course, all of the vanilla chocolate strawberries are still available when it comes to engineering thermoplastics through Conventus. We're happy to work with everybody. But we just wanted to highlight some of the more novel things that I think complement the novel technologies that 3D Fortify is bringing to the table today. So with that, I'll wrap up, send it back over to you, Craig, and talk to you soon.
All right. Thanks, Bob. Here's some more Fortify difference that you get when you use our 3D printed tooling as opposed to some other options. And this really ties in well with what Bob was talking about from Conventus, in that when you're prototyping and you need some high requirement materials, whether that's PEEK, Ultem, PPSU, glass-filled nylon, glass-filled polycarbonate, you really need something that can withstand those temperatures and pressures. And so that really ties into where material selection becomes super important for your prototyping process. Most times, printed tooling is not going to be able to hold up to those harsh conditions. So you're not going to prototype, you know, an Ultem part with 3D printed tooling. Now, the Fortify difference is that you don't have to worry about your material selection. You're really able to prototype in whatever end use material that you're looking for. So that really opens up the breadth of what materials you're able to use and also what parts you're able to go with. So that depends on the industry, especially if you're a CM. Now you're able to service defense, aerospace, automotive, all the way down to consumer goods where you're really only molding polypro. So while there's no material that would be a non-starter or something that we would definitely not use, there are going to be limitations in the quantity. So when you're running something that's 750 degrees Fahrenheit and also running at 15,000 PSI injection pressure, you're going to produce less parts than you would be if you're running PolyPro at 400 degrees Fahrenheit and 2,000 PSI of injection pressure. With that being said, you can print more tools. They're only about $300 to $400 depending on the size. So if you do need 100 Ultem parts, you are able to produce 50 on one tool and then 50 on another while still being cost effective. So material selection, while important, is no longer something that's a non-starter for 3D printed tooling. So here's a quick materials processing guide. So we have a much more built out one, and this is done on our 30-ton Nisei press. So the injection pressure and speeds actually will be different, but there are ways to calculate those for your press using the intensification ratio of both machines. But as you can see here, we've used polyketone, Ultem, LCP, PET, polycarbonate, nylon, everything that it gets used widely and is considered on the upper edge of 3D printed tooling's capabilities is something that we do every day very regularly. We're also showing here our applications depth, where we're really able to give you the resources that you need in order to be successful with 3D printed tooling, because there are going to be some major differences. As you'll see, the injection pressure is considerably lower, your speeds are considerably lower, and your recommended fill times are significantly higher. Now, that's because we're using sort of a hybrid injection slash extrusion process, where we're trying to fill up the cavity slowly with a constant pressure, as opposed to filling fast and then packing out. We want to make sure that we're not overpressurizing the cavity and not deflecting any pieces of the mold. And that's a key part of how to increase the longevity of your tool. The other thing I'm sure you'll notice is that the cooling times are significantly higher. Now, this is because, like I mentioned previously, we're using an insulator as opposed to actively cooling the tool. Our tools are actually just sucking away heat, but retaining it. So it's going to cool, but it's not going to cool quickly. So that presents some challenges with a material like PET, where the crystallization happens sort of in that temperature range. So depending on the type of PET part you're making, it may not be feasible at this moment, like a PET preform, when you need really low crystallinity, it's going to be difficult to get that without active cooling. And that's something that we're working on today and have some pretty exciting results but nothing yet that's quite productized. So there are some limitations there, but you can mold PET. So if crystalline PET is something that you are working with, that should be no issue at all. So here's another really unique thing about Fortify, is that we actually have a calculator that will spit out the expected shot count. So you know whether or not this is a good fit or whether or not you might need one tool or two tools, depending on the part that you're using. So we take into account some key details, which are the material temperature. So whatever temperature that you're going to be using in the barrels, the MFR range, so how viscous your material is, the crystallinity, which can affect the coefficient of friction, and then the filler percentage, whether that's glass or carbon fiber. All of those factors will produce a number. And then you go through to the feature checklist and you just check yes or no on whether or not your part has these features. And then that number gets compiled with the feature checklist number. And then you're able to actually get your expected shot count. So for this part that you see here, our expected shot count is 100 to 250. That's usually on the lower side. So we would expect really to get above 250 shots with this part, but we want to make sure that we're setting our expectations correctly. So somewhere in that range is what you would expect for this complexity and that material. So it obviously, if you go up and you go to a 750 degree melt temperature and a really low MFR range, you're going to drive that shot count down. But this is a great way to utilize the resources that Fortify can give you so that you can accurately anticipate what you're going to get for your prototyping projects. So here's a great case study that we use with a 30% glass-filled Ultem cutting bit. So some key details here. There's external threads. There's a sacrificial insert that actually creates that cutting edge. And then the processing details are 760 degrees Fahrenheit, so really, really high temperature. We're pushing the boundary for injection pressure for our tooling at 12,000. We've gone up to 15,000 PSI, but that's the highest currently. And then we were using the maximum injection speed. That's because we're not actively heating our tools, the material is freezing off pretty early. So you have to really jack up the heat and then push it on the injection speed so that you can really fill up the cavity without cooling off too quickly. Here's some lead time reduction. So you're seeing up at the top is what you would expect for an aluminum tool. So that's between a 6 to 8 week lead time. Most of that time is spent out of your facility, just with a tool maker, either being stuck in their queue, waiting for a CNC machine to open up, or doing a ton of mold finishing. So when you go down and you see the mold design for Fortify, you're taking about 1 day for the mold design because it's a simple open and close cavity with a sacrificial insert that you would not be able to do with aluminum. You're really cutting down on your mold design time. So for this particular customer, it was more important to get the prototyping done quickly than it was for them to verify their tool design. So that's what we ended up going with, the sacrificial insert. You get your first print overnight. So it's about an 8-hour print for those parts. You clean and cure them on Tuesday, which is about a 30-minute process. And then they go into the oven for an overnight bake cycle, which is 8 hours. So if you're running a two-shift factory, you're really cutting that lead time down to 1 day instead of two. But then you can come in on Wednesday, and then you're getting your first shots. So for this particular project, we were actually done with the project in 3 days. On that third day, we molded 75 pieces of that Ultem cutting bit, and we're able to ship them out that night. So instead of waiting an extra 7 weeks to get your aluminum tool, and you know, there are some advantages for that aluminum tool, like you'll be able to produce, you know, a lot more parts, but you're for a prototype quantity in that, you know, 50 to 100 to up to 1,000 part range, that extra 7 weeks is far more valuable than being able to produce 2,000 parts on an aluminum tool. So this is a great example of how you can reduce your lead times for prototyping projects, and not just using Fortify tooling, but really using the agility of the Conventus model. So you can order a 50-pound bag of that glass-filled Ultem, get it to you in a week or so, and then you're really able to take advantage of not only 3D printed tooling, fast material lead times, and produce projects on a multiple week basis instead of waiting for 8 weeks. You're able to turn around projects in 2 weeks or less. So here's some customer success that we actually have shared together and really what brought about this partnership and the obvious benefits to it is that Empire Group has been able to blend the agility and the speed of 3D printed tooling with the Conventus high performance line, as well as some of their other materials as well, like ABS and polycarbonate. They've been able to successfully mold LCP, 30% glass filled Ultem, glass filled polycarbonate, ABS, polypro, polycarbonate, neat, and many other resins, not only because of the Fortify tooling and its high strength and high rigidity, but because they've been able to get material super fast and turn around these projects from weeks to days. So now their lead times are dropping considerably for the prototype projects that they're servicing. So this is a really great way to take advantage of both offerings from both companies and really where we see our partnership fitting in that quick turn prototyping space where you're only producing 25 to 1,000 shots and you don't need an entire day load of material. You only need a 50 pound bag. That's a great way to utilize the Conventus system and the Fortify system. And you know, now you can cut your molded part turnaround time from 8 weeks to 3 days. And with that, I think we're going to be opening up our question and answer session. So if you have any questions, please feel free to ask now.